Welcome to the Good News Ride Home for Thursday, July 9th, 2020. I'm Jackson Bird. New research shows that native South Americans may have helped populate Polynesia 800 years ago. Why are men less likely to wear masks? Does wearing a mask make you more attractive? And can we use that reasoning to persuade more people to wear them? And the Dogecoin is back in earnest thanks to a new trend on TikTok. Here are some of the cool things from the news today. A recent study published in the journal Nature sheds new light on the traditionally unpopular theory that native South Americans may have helped populate Polynesia. The study found that people on five Polynesian islands, including Rapa Nui, or Easter Island, have small amounts of DNA that can be traced back to people who lived in Colombia 8 centuries ago. Scholars have long believed that Asian people started venturing east about 3,500 years ago and began populating Polynesia about 1,000 years ago, without ever going over to South America. This new research suggests either Polynesians kept going at some point to South America and then brought some South American people back with them to Polynesia, or that South Americans themselves were the ones to voyage to Polynesia on their own accord. Quoting the New York Times, in an earlier study on Rapa Nui led by Anna Sapfo Malaspinas of the University of Lausanne, researchers analyzed DNA from 27 islanders. They found evidence that the participants had a mixture of Polynesian and Native American ancestry. Some of their Native American DNA appeared to have been inherited from recent immigrants from Chile, but other pieces were different, suggesting they originated from Native Americans many generations earlier. To test that finding, Dr. Estrada, Dr. Sandoval, and their colleagues compared the DNA of 809 people from Rapa Nui and other Polynesian islands, as well as in countries along the Pacific coast, from Mexico to Chile. The researchers found that most of the people on Rapa Nui had some recent Chilean forebears. From them, they inherited both Native American and European DNA. But 6 people had no European ancestry at all. Their Native American ancestry had a different source, the Xenu population of Colombia. The scientists then found some of the same pieces of DNA in people on 4 other islands in eastern Polynesia, end quote. The researchers didn't believe it at first and assumed that they must have done something wrong, but after confirming and diving deeper, they eventually realized that data was true. They then set about measuring the DNA fragments to determine how long ago the Native American ancestors lived. All of the stretches of Xenu DNA were about the same length, meaning that they all came from about the same period of time, which researchers estimate was around 800 years ago. While this would be pretty huge if it were true, not everyone is convinced of its total veracity just yet. Lisa Matisu-Smith, a biological anthropologist at the University of Otago in New Zealand, who was not involved in the study, told the New York Times that, quote, "The study would have been stronger had the researchers compared the Polynesians with other populations, such as people in mainland China. That would help rule out the possibility that what looks like Native American ancestry in Polynesia is actually just DNA inherited from the common ancestors of the two groups in Asia," end quote. One method being employed by Dr. Lars Fehrenschmitz, an anthropological geneticist at the University of California, Santa Cruz, to figure out if South Americans did help populate Polynesia and whether they went there themselves or were first visited by Polynesian voyagers is attempting to locate Polynesian DNA in parts of South America like the Andes or various coastal islands, because it's conceivable that if they traveled there, some of them may have stayed. In 2010, researchers unearthed skulls from Moca Island, just off the coast of Chile, which they said were very Polynesian in shape and form. There will be a lot more research to be done before any definitive answers can be found, but this is something to keep an eye on. Could be very big if true. There is a growing body of research showing the efficacy of face masks in reducing the risk of virus transmission. If you're listening to this podcast, you are probably someone who's on board with wearing a mask, but maybe you have people in your life who aren't. My neighborhood seems to have given up on mask wearing. When I go out for a walk or a run, I'd say only about a third of the people I see tops are wearing masks. A lot of people have been pointing out that it seems like men are less likely to wear masks than women. Now, of course, this isn't true across the board. There are plenty of women who are militant anti-maskers. But a new study out of Middlesex University and the Mathematical Sciences Research Institute in Berkeley found that men are indeed less likely to wear masks. And that certainly adds up with what I see in my neighborhood. I'll even see families where the mom and children are all wearing masks and the dad isn't. Or he's got it around his neck or with his nose uncovered. Actually, a popular method that I've seen with dude bros crowding outside of bars is to strap the mask around their bicep. You know, real effective. And studies continue to show that men are more likely to catch coronavirus than women. So if anything, we should be more diligent about mask wearing. And perhaps there's a correlation there, but we don't have the data to show it yet. There's a bunch of other reasons why we might be more likely to get it, everything from hormone levels to working conditions to not asking for help. But that is all for another story, another day. Right now, I want to focus on a more lighthearted take on this, which is the internet trying to find ways to convince people, especially men, to wear face masks. The LA Times created an entire mnemonic device called the Mask Approach to persuade people to wear masks. The Mask Approach was based on conversations with psychologists and the aforementioned study, which found that the male respondents' main reasons for avoiding masks were because they made them look weak and because of the stigma attached to them. So the LA Times' Mask Approach is as follows. M, make it about the community, not the individual. A, appeal to patriotism. S, stick with the stereotypes. And K, key into humor. Now, gotta say, the LA Times gets a D- on effective acrostics here, but the content of each point is good. It's all gonna sound a bit patronizing, but it is based on research. Most of the points boil down to emphasizing the wearing of a mask as a chivalrous, heroic act, and how it's the tough, manly thing to do. Masks that can be markers of identity with things like sports teams or, I don't know, the Supreme logo are thought to be good motivators since men are more likely than women to identify with a team. That and humor, making jokes about Darth Vader, Bane, Lucha Libres, Wild West Bandits, and other manly figures that have worn masks. Like I said, it's all a little patronizing, and some of it feeds into that exact kind of toxic masculinity we're trying to undo, but it is based on real research and comparable examples, like an early 2000s campaign that successfully got men to talk about mental health by framing it as real men, real depression, and using a firefighter and retired Air Force officer in the marketing. Or the simple proliferation of gendered products that genuinely do sell. The LA Times points out that if you search manly mask on Etsy, you get, quote, a treasure trove of options that practically ooze testosterone. Masks in lumberjack plaids and bandana patterns or adorned with tractors, cigars, whiskey bottles, trout, handlebar mustaches, and the Minnesota Vikings team logo for starters, end quote. Now, GQ, a magazine aimed at men, took it all a step further with a thorough piece titled, Does Wearing a Mask Make You Look Hot? They brought up the recent photo of Chris Pine that briefly broke the internet and propelled him to the coveted position of Best Chris, in which he was pictured leaving a local bookstore with a huge bag of books and wearing a face mask. People were enamored with his support of intellect, small businesses, and public health. It seems many of us who are pro-mask have found that others wearing masks are attractive because it shows that someone cares about their own and the community's health. But GQ was curious if the mask itself makes us physically more attractive. They spoke to Vanessa Brown, a senior lecturer in design and culture at Nottingham Trent University, who has written about how sunglasses tend to increase someone's attractiveness to others. GQ asked if masks may be having a similar effect. Brown told them, quote, there's definitely something about the replacement of something fleshy and vulnerable, i.e. your face, with something that's engineered and machined and perfect, end quote. She also points out that face coverings, particularly on men, have typically been associated in Western culture with risky activities like outlaws and bandanas, and risk is usually associated with coolness, so we may be connecting those two unconsciously in our heads, even for sterile-looking medical masks. Brown further brings up the air of mystery created by covering a part of your face. Quote, where people cover the face but the eyes are visible, it's quite attractive because you're drawn into that potential intimacy because the eyes are there, but you're also made aware of the fact that a lot of other things are being withheld from you. End quote. A separate study published in Nature earlier this year indicated that people found faces in incomplete photographs to be more attractive, going along a bit with that air of mystery. If you don't know what's underneath, you may make up a hopeful guess. But a 2016 study published in Japanese Psychological Research found the opposite. The researchers discovered that perceived attractiveness actually decreased when wearing a, quote, sanitary mask. Though part of the reasoning there was that people were perceived to be unhealthy, whereas now mask wearing is encouraged for everyone, sick or not. So if there are people in your life that are reluctant to wear a mask, maybe some of these strategies or reasons will help convince them. If not, perhaps this clip that Bill Nye posted to TikTok yesterday will do the trick.
So the reason we want you to wear a mask is to protect you, sure. But the main reason we want you to wear a mask is to protect me from you and the particles from your respiratory system from getting into my respiratory system. Everybody, this is a matter literally of life and death. And when I use the word literally, I mean literally a matter of life and death.
Quickly going back to that study from Middlesex and Berkeley that showed men are less likely to wear masks, they made one very important point, quoting the LA Times. The biggest motivator of all is a mandatory mask order. In that instance, the authors write, the gender difference on the intention to wear a mask almost disappears, end quote. And I believe it. I mean, personally, I was pretty nervous about being made fun of or aggressively coughed on if I wore a mask out and about in the early days, even though I personally believed it was a good idea. I only felt safe doing it once New York City made it mandatory for public spaces where social distancing isn't an option, because then I thought if someone gives me a hard time, I can at least counter with how it's what officials say we're supposed to do. And I'm sure I'm not the only one who felt that way. So basically, we can joke about all of these ways to persuade people of all genders to wear masks, but maybe the thing that really needs to happen is more action from local officials. Dogecoin is back. Well, I guess technically it never went away, but it did kind of leave the public consciousness for a while. And now, TikTokers have brought the meme-themed cryptocurrency back in the spotlight. But let's rewind real quick, quoting Know Your Meme. Dogecoin is an alternative cryptocurrency, or altcoin, that uses the iconic Shiba Inu dog from the Doge meme as a mascot. Similar to Bitcoin and its derivatives, Dogecoin can be mined and exchanged for goods and services among the participants, though it is programmed to level out at a higher threshold of up to 100 billion coins and prevent any use of special Bitcoin mining equipment like ASICs. In comparison, Bitcoin will cap out at 21 million coins, and Litecoin will support up to 84 million coins in circulation, end quote. And rewinding a bit further, quoting Motherboard, the Doge meme is based on an obscure short video from Homestar Runner, an early internet repository of viral comedy videos in which a puppet version of Homestar Runner spells dog as Doge, D-O-G-E. Years later, the spelling was revived on Reddit, ported to Tumblr, and eventually developed into the Shiba Confessions blog, which Know Your Meme says popularized image macros of Sheebs with their thoughts pasted on top in Comic Sans, end quote. The Doge became the figurehead of the Doge coin in 2013 when Jackson Palmer and Billy Marcus started the cryptocurrency as a bit of a joke. At the time, a lot of alternative cryptocurrencies were popping up with names like WorldCoin, AnonCoin, SexCoin. So Palmer photoshopped a Shiba Inu onto a coin and tweeted jokingly that he was investing in Dogecoin. The tweet took off and his friends encouraged him to make it a real thing. So he did. And it spread more than he probably ever could have imagined. As Dogecoin skyrocketed over the next several years, and occasionally crashed, online communities and the official Dogecoin Foundation performed a number of charitable and silly acts with the currency, including raising money to send the Jamaican bobsled team to the 2014 Sochi Winter Olympics and sponsoring NASCAR driver Josh Wise's car at Talladega. Now, some people on TikTok are on a mission to get the Dogecoin's price to $1 by encouraging people to invest in it. It's currently at $0.0039. The highest it ever reached was $0.017 in January 2018. Still, that $0.0039 represents a surge of 40% in the last 24 hours. And honestly, if any cryptocurrency can pull it off by sheer popular spread among broad masses of people who barely know what cryptocurrency is, Dogecoin can. It's exactly what it's always done. Quoting Bloomberg, videos proselytizing Dogecoin have been popping up for days on the platform, known for its short but quirky and catchy video compilations. Some Dogecoin fans say the whole phenomenon might be a crazy thought, while others have been more blunt, prodding users to all get rich and to tell everyone you know. One user slowly zooms onto a paper prototype of the coin with "Fly Me to the Moon" playing in the background. Another says that if this keeps trending on TikTok, this might actually be my saving grace. Justin Litchfield, who is the Austin, Texas-based chief technology officer at ProChain Capital, a crypto hedge fund, says that there are two trends at play. One is the hordes of people stuck at home who have been buying stocks on apps like Robinhood and who might now also be dabbling in crypto. The other is the repeat phenomenon of Dogecoin investors getting together to do a pump and dump for kicks. Take, for instance, April of 2019, when it saw double-digit gains in a similar fashion. "This has a strong history of having done this," said Litchfield. "The whole currency was started as a joke to make fun of the financial system, which is bizarre to think about," end quote. The Dogecoin Twitter account, not run by founders Palmer and Marcus, tweeted yesterday, quote, "Be mindful of the intentions people have when they direct you to buy things. None of them are in the spot to be financially advising. Make choices right for you. Do not ride other people's FOMO or manipulation. Stay safe. Be smart," end quote. While it's all a funny and interesting occurrence, the Dogecoin Twitter is right that a lot of people pushing the trend are potentially up to no good. TikTok, like so many places on the internet, is rife with people trying to take advantage of others. In the second half of 2019, TikTok deleted 49 million videos for breaking their policies. About a quarter of those broke child protection policies, including content with harmful imitative behavior, and about 20% showed illegal activities, including regulated goods. The point being that there are bad actors everywhere, and especially where young people congregate. But on the positive side of things, the kids are all right. They're smart, digitally savvy, and this is probably a good chance for a lot of them to learn a bit about cryptocurrency, finance, and the all-important history of memes. That is all for today. As always, this show was produced by Ride Home Media. I'm Jackson Bird. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I will talk to you tomorrow.